This is Sports Spectrum, the sports and faith podcast where we bring Jesus into the conversation. Here's your host, Jason Romano.
Hey guys, welcome to Sports Spectrum. I am Jason Romano. My email address, jason@sportsspectrum.com, jason@sportsspectrum.com. I'd love to hear from you. Any guest ideas you have, any thoughts on today's interview with Freddie Coleman from ESPN Radio, you can reach me directly, jason@sportsspectrum.com. And we are presented today by IJM, the International Justice Mission, helping to protect more than 150 million people from violence across the world. You can join that fight right now to end slavery in our lifetime by visiting the website ijm.org/TF, ijm.org/TF to become a Freedom Partner today. We're also presented today by Compassion International, and COVID-19 right now has left nearly 70,000 children stuck in poverty without a sponsor. And here's an opportunity for you to help release a child from poverty by checking out their website, partnering with Compassion and professional athletes to help release children from poverty. Go to the website, compassion.com/teamup, compassion.com/teamup, and help release a child from poverty today. Very excited to welcome to Sports Spectrum Freddie Coleman. He is an ESPN Radio national radio host. He's been at ESPN Radio since 2004, and you won't find a nicer guy and a better dude than Freddie Coleman. He and I go way back, and we intersected certainly for 13 years during my tenure at ESPN. He got there in 2004. I got there a few years earlier. I left in 2017. He's still going strong here in 2020 and just signed a new contract with ESPN Radio. He co-hosts Freddie and Fitzsimmons from 9 p.m. Eastern to midnight Eastern on ESPN Radio, national radio. So he does the evening show. And this conversation with Freddie was fantastic. I mean, such a great dude. And we were able to do this interview in person since he lives here in Connecticut. I'm still here in Connecticut. And we were able to do the interview in person. The first interview that we've done in person here on Sports Spectrum since COVID-19. It's nice not to have to jump on a Zoom call for an interview. And Freddie and I were able to connect in person, 6 feet apart, social distance, of course, fist bumping and not hugging, and still record a pretty awesome interview. So take a listen to Freddie Coleman from ESPN Radio joining us here today on Sports Spectrum. What's up, buddy?
I am good, my friend. How are you, brother?
I'm great. ESPN Radio host Freddie Coleman, and you just signed a new contract, and I saw it go all out on Twitter. People are thanking you and congratulating you for all that you've done for the company and just excited for all that God is doing. How cool was that to get that contract?
I'm still trying to wrap my head around it, Jason, because I tell people all the time, you just never know who's out there paying attention, mm-hmm. but you never go through life, at least I don't go through life thinking about those kind of things. I know how blessed I've been to be a part of ESPN Radio for 16 plus years. Most people in our business, whether it's locally or regionally or even on a national level, they may not last 16 minutes or even 16 seconds.
Seriously.
So just to see and hear that feedback from so many different people, not only just on the ESPN side, but also in different areas in TV and radio, just even people hitting me on Twitter that listen to the show and say, I've been a fan for years. I'm really happy for you. I know that I've always been blessed being here, but having that kind of blessing come back to me was still something that I'm still shaking my head at. So I know exactly there's never a reason to take any of that for granted ever.
It's interesting too, isn't it, Freddie, when you do something like that, and I was at a different level, a much smaller level, I think, when I left ESPN, but you see the people that you've touched when a moment like that happens, the announcement that, hey, he's going to be back for a couple more years and he just signed this new deal, or hey, he's going on to another opportunity and he spent a long time working with one place. And it's almost like a eulogy at a funeral, but you're allowed to hear it and see it.
True. That's a great description, because it's an appropriate description from the standpoint of, you never worry about, at least I don't worry about being celebrated, because this was something I never thought I would ever be a part of growing up in Brooklyn, New York. Mm-hmm. People on radio, I put them on the same level as athletes, as actors, as actresses, yes. as singers. I never thought in a million years I'd be a part of the medium like this and be a part of the medium to this level for this long. So just hearing and seeing that, it was still really a head-shaking thing. I said, wow, we've been able to create something here that has that kind of appreciation, but that doesn't mean I'm going to stop. If people thought that I appreciated them a lot before, wait until they see what's going to be in the future, where I'm going to be able to stand on their shoulders and reward the faith they have in our show and that they have in me.
I love it. I thought it was great, and I love the response, and I thought, you know, not a more deserving person than Freddie Coleman when you see the reaction and what everybody was saying. It's true. And I know, you know, we are a people. I told someone earlier, and you and I were talking about this too, that, you know, words of affirmation is one of the love languages, if you will, in the Five Love Languages book. But we as human beings, it's nice to hear when we're appreciated.
Right.
Not that we're looking for it and we're trying to be all prideful.
Sure.
But it's nice when you know that the work that you've put in is recognized, but even more that I can't count the amount of people who posted back to you that said, a great broadcaster, an even better person. And you hear and you realize, oh, wait, I'm impacting people's lives on a deeper level than just talking about sports.
But the one thing about it is, and I'm really appreciative of that from that standpoint with those words and the well wishes, but I always tell people you have to be happy with yourself and validate yourself.
Yeah.
You shouldn't worry about trying to validate yourself to other people, because then you can get lost. You lose your focus on what's important or who's important. So if people are able to see the way you carry yourselves, even they never, ever tell you, but if they see that and they get inspiration from that, that's fantastic. But you got to be able to find that faith and inspiration in yourself. So no matter what happens, I want people to always know they're getting 100% of me. I'm going to give you everything I have and then some. And that goes beyond the professional level. That's also in the personal level. So if you get inspiration by that, that's fantastic. Believe me, I'm going to be very, very thankful that people feel that way. But I want to make sure that I want to validate and appreciate myself and be happy with myself, because I would hate to think that people are finding inspiration from an unhappy person. Mm. I would hate that somebody has that inspiration, but on the inside, I'm not happy. I don't think I'm doing myself or anybody else any favors if I'm not happy with myself and want to put my best foot forward.
Yeah, it's good. Freddie Coleman's our guest here on Sports Spectrum. So where does sports, is sports something that was like ingrained in you from being a little boy growing up? You said you grew up in Brooklyn. Were you just the sports nerd that loved and craved and watched and played sports?
Oh my goodness. I must have driven my mom and dad crazy. Not so much because I love sports, because we're a sports family. My mom and dad, they love baseball, they love basketball, they love football, they love tennis. But I used to be in the basement and I would broadcast games as they were going on, because I love broadcasters. I love Chris Schenkel. I love Kurt Gowdy.
Yeah.
I love Keith Jackson. I love people like that. And I thought that was something I wanted to do. I wanted to be just like them, Jason, from that standpoint.
Okay.
And I'm sure my mom and dad must have thought I was the strangest kid on planet Earth, thinking, okay, someone's broadcasting the game, but that sounds like my son downstairs doing that. And I did it all the time. And I was such a sports nerd or sports geek. I created my own football and basketball leagues and had players and had a draft. So that really was ingrained in myself from being a young kid. And I can't tell you exactly when that moment happened. It just was one of those things that it gradually became a part of me and I became a part of it. But I guarantee you, my mom and dad must look back at those days when I was a kid and thinking, man, we knew he loved sports, but we didn't realize to that level. But nobody could have ever seen this way back when I was growing up in Brooklyn, New York.
Who were the heroes? Who were the guys? Who were the posters on your wall as a kid? Who were the guys that you were like, that's my guy?
Three to this day. Roger Staubach, without question. He's still my favorite football player of all time.
Yep.
Joe Namath, because he was, as a Jets fan, he was the first Christmas gift I ever got that was sports related, where my mom and dad got the whole uniform, helmet, shoulder pads, knee pads, everything. There's still a picture of me as a six-year-old, Christmas of 1971, where I have the Joe Namath outfit on. I'm faking like I'm throwing a football pass.
I love it.
They still have that. And Walt Frazier, growing up in New York as a New York Knicks fan, just the way he was and how he played. And there was never a rushed atmosphere about him. He always seemed to be in control, where everybody's going 75 miles an hour, but he was always going 55 miles an hour. But yeah, he was always ahead of the game. He's always a step ahead of the players. So to this day, those are my three sports heroes. I've been able to accumulate other heroes along the way, but those are the three growing up as a kid that to this day, I still have a high and mighty about them when it comes to Roger Staubach, Joe Namath, and also Walt Frazier.
Have you talked to them, interviewed them, even met them? Obviously, you've been at ESPN now for a long time, 16 years, 17 years. Have you been able to meet those heroes and interview them and have that sort of moment with them?
I've met two out of the three.
Okay.
I met or talked to them. I just talked to Joe Namath this year. We had him on as an interview.
Okay.
And believe me, that was a knee-knocking experience.
Yeah.
Talking with somebody that people still don't realize what kind of icon and pioneer Joe Namath was, because there is no Super Bowl, there is no NFL merger without what he did.
Mm-hmm.
And being that first bonus baby quarterback, playing in an inferior league at that time, the AFL, and then they beat the superior NFL in the Super Bowl III game, and then that changed everything in the course of history when it comes to the National Football League. So having a chance to talk with him earlier this year on radio was fantastic.
So cool.
And I met Roger Staubach in an Army-Navy game when I worked for the Army Football Network, and we're out there walking before the game on the field. That was my first Army-Navy game after seeing it on TV all those years, having a chance to be a part of the Army broadcast team. And lo and behold, 20 yards away is Roger Staubach. And I said, I don't care if security tackles me before I get to him. I'm going to walk up and tell him how much he means to me. I say, this is Captain America.
Yeah.
Tom Brady's called Captain America now. That was the original one.
Yes, it was.
When it comes to Roger Staubach. And he was so gracious and so nice. And just, he was talking with me and my friend as if we had known each other all our lives.
Wow.
And I said, I always had a high esteem for him, but it was even higher after that. Walt Frazier is still like the holy grail one I have not had a chance to meet or talk with. But having a chance to talk to two out of three or be around two out of three, I'll take those odds any day of the week.
Absolutely. My heroes as a kid were Daryl Strawberry.
Oh.
Got to meet him
and
have become friends with Daryl, which is just even more surreal. But I was a Cowboys fan and still am a Cowboys fan. And Danny White and Tony Dorsett were my heroes as kids.
Right.
So I'm a little younger than you. Yeah. So I skew into the early to mid 80s as a fan. Got to meet them.
Really?
And I met Tony at ESPN. Actually, Dan Patrick, one day back in the day, this is like 2002, had Tony Dorsett in studio to do an interview. And I'm not even sure why he was in Bristol.
Right.
But Paul Papps, the old producer
for
Dan, who still works for Dan today,
mm-hmm.
said, hey, Romano, I know you're a big Cowboys fan. Tony Dorsett's going to be here in like an hour on the show. I said, well, can I meet him? He's like, we could probably make it happen, but it's got to be quick. I'm like, that's fine.
Right.
Freddie, this is the early days of digital cameras. I lived 2 minutes from ESPN.
Mm-hmm.
So I drove home, got my digital camera, got a football.
Right.
And I brought it back to ESPN. You know, you're not supposed to do this.
Yeah, they frown on that at times.
Every so often, you can do it when you know it's your guy. It's
right.
kind of the Roger Staubach. If they tackle me,
so
they tackle
it.
Me.
Right.
This was how I felt with Tony Dorsett. And I went in, and I think Papsy took the picture. I still have it downstairs of me and Tony Dorsett.
Really?
And the football that he signed to Jason, my very best always, Tony Dorsett, number 33.
Wow.
I said, that's going on the mantle. And that is going, it's in the man cave now. And that was an amazing, it was brief,
mm-hmm.
but you're meeting your hero.
Yeah.
Now, the third person, kind of like your Walt Frazier for me, was Larry Bird.
Oh.
Now, I've never met Larry Legend.
Right.
I'm afraid to meet Larry Legend because I had him on such a, not afraid, but I had him on such a pedestal.
Yeah.
And sometimes that happens. We know this. We've mm-hmm. talked to many athletes and they don't always live up to the billing that you would hope that they would live up to because
right.
of the pedestal that you put them on
mm-hmm.
as fans.
Yeah.
So Larry's the one I haven't met. We'll see. Have you ever met Larry Bird?
I've never met Larry Bird, but it's funny you mentioned him because somebody asked me about 3 years ago, Jason, who are the basketball players I still miss playing. And I'm sure they're probably going to think it was, as a Knicks fan, it's going to be Patrick Ewing or everybody was a Michael Jordan fan. The four guys I still miss are Walt Frazier, definitely, Julius Erving, Dr. J, because he was the first one as a kid where he was doing superhuman things that people weren't doing. And he, to me, he was like the first kid kind of basketball player that kids wanted to be like because of what he was doing. But the other two guys are Larry Bird and Magic Johnson,
mm-hmm.
because I remember the first time I saw Larry Bird play basketball on TV, because we're talking back in the late 70s where he played Indiana State. He only appeared in one game in his career in a regular season on TV. That was the last game he played against Wichita State. And at that time, he was this Paul Bunyan character where you didn't think he existed. You only read stories about him in the newspapers. But did this guy actually exist?
Yeah.
And then the last game they showed it in the before the NCAA tournament, he just lit up Wichita State. He had like 40-plus points hitting jumpers. And I fell in love with him from that minute when it came to Larry Bird. And even when they lost to Magic Johnson in the championship game that year, Indiana State versus Michigan State, those two guys, I just loved the way they played basketball. Then they carried that into the NBA, where I didn't have a rooting interest. I didn't care who won, but seeing both of those guys. So those are still the four guys I miss. Dr. J, Walt Frazier, Larry Bird, and Magic Johnson above anybody else in basketball.
I miss Larry and Magic. And I even miss Michael, you know, to mm-hmm. an extent. I think I didn't appreciate MJ in the 90s, I was kind of sick, kind of like Brady now,
right?
And the Patriots, you're just kind of sick of them winning every year. And in about 10 or 20 years, there'll be a Last Dance type of documentary on these Patriot teams.
Sure.
And you'll be like, oh my gosh, like what in the world were they doing? Because you look back at the 90s Bulls and you thought, holy cow, like they're dominating every year Jordan was playing from 91 to 98.
Yeah.
So I think we don't appreciate it as much.
Yeah.
For you, when does the moment happen when you realize, oh, I'm not just practicing this in my parents' basement. I'm actually thinking about going into this industry and then having the opportunities that God has brought you through to be where you are today.
I never wanted to be a sports talk radio host because growing up, there were no sports talk radio stations.
Right.
I know that's kind of something that people can't wrap their heads around now, but back when I was growing up, there was only really one sports talk radio guy, and his name was Art Rush Jr. And he did a nightly show on WABC in New York City, 770 AM. He was really the first guy that people should really know about that kind of got this started. And I used to listen to him religiously, but it was on a talk radio station because ABC used to be music radio, and then they switched over. That was a sad day for me because I loved listening to a radio station as a kid, listening to music.
Yeah.
So with the talk radio, I'm thinking, what's this talk radio nonsense? What are you doing to me at 13 years of age that you're doing this? But I never missed his show with Art Rush Jr. Then I got more in the music radio because I wanted to be that next great FM jock. I wanted to be Scott Muni from WNEW, Frankie Crocker from WBLS, Kent Spiderweb also worked on that station. Those were the heroes to me in radio that I wanted to be like. So when WFAN got started in 1987, I'll never get the first day they had it. It was so big that it led the news in New York because Jim Lampley did the first show ever on WFAN. And I said, let me get this straight. There's a station that's going to talk 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, sports. Where do I sign up for that? And right. I was a religious listener immediately with WFAN. But I never thought I'd actually work there because I wanted to be an FM radio jock and spin Jimi Hendrix and spin the Police and everything like that. That's where my focus was at that time.
That's awesome. Before we continue in learning that journey, because I think it's a great one, tell me where faith is. Growing up, where was the intersection of faith in your life and kind of when did that take shape for you?
It really started with my mom because she would take me and my sister to church every Sunday. And I got a chance to see what faith looks like in my mother, Maddie Coleman, each and every day because she still reads her Bible every day now. She still goes to church. She still tithes.
Mm-hmm.
I was able to see that from that standpoint that it wasn't fake with my mom. I could clearly tell the ones that were, I don't want to say fake Christians because that's not really the right kind of designation to put on people.
Sure.
You really don't know them if you had not had a chance to talk with them.
That's right.
But it seemed that there was a realness to how she was going about it and still goes about it to this day, Jason, compared to other people. So it's always cool talking religion with my mom, talking faith with my mom, because that really got started for me where it wasn't just an Easter Sunday thing. It wasn't just a Passover thing. It wasn't just a Christmas thing. It's an everyday thing with her, and it's an everyday thing with me where no matter what, after I wake up, before I go to bed, I give thanks to my Lord and Savior because without him, there is no Freddie Coleman. There's no Jason Romano.
Yeah.
There is no anybody else. And I never, ever would never want God to have look at me and say, he doesn't appreciate what I do for this world, no matter what is going on. He never has to worry about that with me because I always appreciate because he doesn't have to do that. He doesn't have to step in. He doesn't have to be there to allow us to stand on his shoulders or to lean on him to get us through tough times and understand that we are conduits for him and that our place has to be realized from that standpoint. But that really got started with my mom, Maddie Coleman, because I got a chance to see that, okay, so that's what it looks like and that's how you should understand it because she gives great examples of being that way each and every day.
Did you ever struggle as you got older with sort of following, living out that faith on your own? I know for a lot of people who had examples like your mom, they call that the foundation. Like we wouldn't be here if it wasn't for the people that came before us that showed us what it meant to be a Christian or live out our faith. But then we have to go out and do this on our own.
Right.
And mom's not necessarily there every day to walk you through or to take you to church. You have to kind of live through this on your own.
Yeah.
Any struggles there at all? Any push-pulls or things that you were kind of focused on that you realized, oh, wait, my faith is kind of not priority here. I got to get this going.
I was lost for a long time. I'll be completely honest. When it wasn't so much when I got to college or even in high school, but when you're trying to make your way in the world and you feel that you have to be a certain something, to other people, whether it's a relationship or whether it's people on the outside looking in, that you really shouldn't try to be on their good side. You shouldn't try to endear yourself to them, but you believe that you have to, whether it's from a professional standpoint or a personal standpoint. So for the longest time, I was trying to do things on my own. Say, I know God is there, but, you know, I got to do this. I can't put this on God. He's got enough to think about. Or saying, you know what, God, I got to make this work for me. Not saying I don't need you, but I need you to step aside. And I had to realize as I got older, God never steps aside. But if you allow him to do that, if you put him in a position to do that, then it's not going to work out well for you. And for the longest time, every time Jason, I would take a step forward, I was moving myself two steps backwards because I didn't appreciate it or I didn't realize exactly how I should take that lesson, good or bad, and learn from it and be a better person because of it. So everything came to a head right about 2002 when I joined Beulah Baptist Church, Poughkeepsie, New York. And I'll never forget it. My friend Douglas, who I played basketball with, he was asking what church do I belong to. And I said, well, I'm really a Baptist faith, but I don't have a church right now. He said, you should really come and, you know, come to my church on Sunday. I'm not forcing you to do anything. You can come when you want. But I think what you may be thinking about or looking for, that may be the place for you. And I realized he wasn't talking about the church. He was talking about the people inside of the church. And the second I got there, it was a different feeling. And Reverend Jesse Bottoms, who is a friend to the friend to the friend, has been a major influence in my life because I saw how the way he carried himself and how he was able to organize that church. Hmm. And it was based on faith and people, not based on religion. Yeah. And there is a difference.
Big time.
Right. The minute that I got to Beulah and I was able to be around that and have that imparted to me, that's when things changed. I was no longer lost anymore.
Wow. So what happened then? From the moment that that takes place for you personally, professionally, spiritually, you say you weren't lost anymore, but then what happens? Because then it's like, oh, we still have to wake up and go into the world and go to our job every day and live our life. So what changes?
Everything became clear for me in terms of how many times you hear people say slow down, but you'll still be able to get ahead. I was able to slow things down in my mind. And the one thing that he taught us is that you should always continue to learn about yourself because you're going to have to.
Yeah.
Every day is not going to be the same, and you're not going to be the same every day. And there are going to be lessons that you're still going to learn. There are going to be slip-ups that are going to happen. There are going to be times you make the wrong decision. You may have had the right idea, but the end result did not happen the way you wanted to. And that's okay because you're not the first person that's happened to. You're not going to be the last person that's happened to. That's what really changed for me, where I believe I became a better person. And I'll go to one example about how that church had an influence on me. Right when I first got the ESPN Radio about to be hired, I was going to buy a new car. And I take my dad with me because my dad, he knows cars like everybody knows the back of their hand. My daughter, Breon, has the best quote of all time saying, if grandpa can't fix it, then throw it out. It can't be fixed. That's how much faith I have in him because of his expertise about knowing about cars.
Yeah.
And the salesman had promised me one car that was there on the lot. And I guess some miscommunication happened. And he wound up giving the car to somebody else when we were there to pick it up. So my dad is really bent. Like, I can't believe they did this, blah, blah, blah. And my first thought was, okay, if this was 10, 12 years ago, me and my dad have been arguing this guy and yelling at this guy. And who's that benefiting?
Right.
And I said, well, that blue car, is that for sale over there? It's the same make and model. And it seems to be better than that one. He goes, yeah, let me check it out. So he goes over there and he checks it. I said, yeah, if you want that one, that's the one for you. I said, you know what? Let me check it out. Me and my dad will take a test drive. We take a test drive. We wound up taking the blue car that lasted for years with me when I first got the ESPN Radio. Mm-hmm. And my dad said, I'm really glad you were here today. And I go, what do you mean? He said, because you calmed me down to realize there was something else, that just because that car wasn't there and maybe he decided to give it to somebody else doesn't mean there wasn't something else. That's when I realized that Beulah and Reverend Jesse Bottoms and having that clarity really helped me because wow. I was able to see a different way of, okay, that's not there. That means there's something else. And it goes to the old line that one door closes, another door is going to be open for you. That was a clarity that I didn't know I needed, but I knew I had to find it. And I'm glad that it found me more than the other way around.
That's a really great story. I love how you talked about when you first got to ESPN Radio too. Let's go back a little bit because you and I didn't intersect here, but we have something in common in the 518 area code.
Yep, we do.
You worked in Albany, I'm from Albany and worked in Albany as well before you, and then I came to ESPN in 2000. You got there in 04, I believe. So we missed each other by a few years. But you were cutting your teeth a little bit in Albany, New York as well. So take us through a little bit of this progression on your journey as a broadcaster that leads up to 2004 and coming to the worldwide leader.
I had always wanted to work in Albany when I worked in Poughkeepsie, New York. It just seemed like a very cool area to work in. And then I got a chance to do that first part-time and then full-time, first in 2002 part-time, where I was working for the sports radio station and also the classic rock station, Pix 106 on the weekends.
Yeah.
The people make that Capital District, and I've been able to have so many relationships with people that have carried me through this day. And a lot of what I learned in Albany, Jason, has really helped me in ESPN Radio all those years, because Albany is what I call friendly competitive. Mm-hmm. And what I mean by that is, people are going to help you, but there's a competition factor.
Sure.
And that's really cool that you did that right, you did that wrong. Hey, don't do this, don't do that. But they're also working on their game as well, because that fosters great people, that fosters great radio, that fosters great relationships when you have that kind of great competition. So being up there and learning about the area, whether it was Tony Niskayuna over here or going north towards Glens Falls or Saratoga Springs, doing football games for Amsterdam High School and seeing that game day experience, where I'm thinking this little small town north of Albany, about an hour and 10 minutes, but they really love their sports up there and they support their sports.
Yes.
And seeing the band come out there and going into town and saying, oh man, we listen to you do the games on radio. Thanks so much for the support and everything like that. So Albany, even though I wasn't born there and even though I wasn't there for more than a minute, it's still really ingrained in me because of the great atmosphere and the great times that I had helping to be Freddie Coleman professionally and personally. And a lot of what I was able to learn there and be a part of, I've been able to impart that with ESPN Radio and having that as a part of my DNA from a professional standpoint. So it always is going to be a soft spot and a great spot in my heart working in the Capital District. That's why I go back every year to visit people. And I'm blessed to do Coach versus Cancer with my friends Tony Marino and being a part of that, helping out the American Cancer Society in the Capital District. So that's a place that if it was a lot closer than it is, I probably would commute all every day from the Capital District.
I know.
That's how much of an impact it made on me being up there.
We'll get back to our conversation with Freddie Coleman in just a little bit, but I want to tell you some more about our friends at IJM, in a place right now where violence is a threat to people around the world who are poor with COVID-19 upon us. It's as much a part of daily life as hunger, disease, or homelessness, and it's often overlooked, but not by IJM. They believe that every person deserves to be safe and free from violence, and by partnering with local authorities to rescue victims of violence, bring criminals to justice, restore survivors, and strengthen justice systems, IJM is helping to protect more than 150 million people from violence across the world. But it's work they cannot do alone. They need your help. They need our help. The help of Freedom Partners, some of IJM's most loyal partners in the work of justice, and their support of $24 or more each month helps survivors of slavery and violence from the moment they're rescued until they are fully restored. If you want to join the fight to end slavery in our lifetime, you can visit the website right now, ijm.org/TF, ijm.org/TF, to become a Freedom Partner today. We're also presented today by Compassion International, and COVID-19 right now has left nearly 70,000 children without a Compassion International sponsor. That's the capacity of an average NFL stadium. And as the world is in the grips of COVID-19, it's led to more sickness, parents can't work, food is scarce. But Compassion International is doing something about it. Right now, they and some of their pro athlete friends have teamed up to respond to this challenge. They're hoping to fill the stadium with urgent support for a stadium's worth of children in crisis, 70,000 children possibly without a sponsor because of COVID-19. And here's how you can help. You can donate, especially right now during these critical next 12 months, and every donation helping to fill a seat toward a year of needed funding. You can join this team with a donation at any level by going to the website, compassion.com/teamup. Compassion.com/teamup, and pray about it. Pray about sponsoring a child today. Now back to our conversation with Freddie Coleman from ESPN Radio, joining us here today on Sports Spectrum. So where does suddenly coming to Bristol, Connecticut and working full time for the worldwide leader yeah. take place? Because yeah. that story in itself, everybody has one of those stories.
Right.
So what's that story for you?
Well, Jason Barrett, a friend of ours, he was producing Game Night at that time.
Yeah.
And
I produced that show as well,
yeah,
briefly,
exactly.
for 2 years with old Chuck Wilson and Chris Moore.
Oh, my goodness. And we talked about that all the time. Like when I first got the ESPN Radio, Chuck Wilson, when he saw you in the hallway, he said, that was one of my producers. I said, Jason? He goes, oh, yeah. He produced Game Night for a little bit.
I love that guy.
And, so do I. Chuck Wilson really taught me so much about the fabric of ESPN Radio.
Yeah.
But Jason Barrett was producing Weekend Game Night at that time. And he called me on a Monday in May. Because Jason and I have known each other from when we worked in Hudson Valley, when he produced shows, when I was working on TV for the local Cablevision affiliate. It started as Media One, then Cablevision took it over, yeah. and also working in radio. And he said, how married are you to the Tobin and Coleman show, which I was working with John Tobin. That was the afternoon drive show on the Fox affiliate in Albany. And mm-hmm. I go, what do you mean by that? And he said, well, we got an opening here at Game Night, and I think you'd be perfect for it from that standpoint. So I said, what do I have to do? He says, well, send me in your stuff, send it to me, and send it to Dave Zaslowski, who was in charge of Weekend Game Night as a program director.
Love Dave Z.
Yep, who's working in Chicago now, doing great things, as a matter of fact.
That's great.
And so I get a call from Dave later on that week. He said, yeah, we'd like to bring you down for an audition. So at first I'm thinking, I hope Jason's not playing a practical joke on me, but Jason and I have known each other way too long, and I don't know who this Dave Zaslowski is, but I don't think he's part of the joke
yeah.
from that standpoint. So he gave me all the particulars, Jason. I come down, I check into the hotel. I go to the ESPN campus. Now, for those who've never been there, if you've ever wanted to be at the place, the first time you drive up to the gates, it's really a surreal experience because the Stuart Scotts of the world, God rest his soul, the Bob Lees, yep. the Linda Cones, the Robin Roberts.
Legends.
Absolutely, the Chris Bermans, at one time or another, were able to drive through those gates and either audition or go to work. So I had to really compose myself a little bit and say, wow, I said, I can't believe I'm actually on this campus right now. And I get to the front of the gate and I say, hi, I'm Freddie Coleman here for audition, ESPN Radio. Oh, yeah, building two, you're right here on the list and everything. Go right over there and park. So I get upstairs and I see Jace. I was so thrilled to see him.
Yeah.
I meet John Seibel for the first time because Seibel is the main host of Weekend Game Night.
Great
guy. And he's still one of my friends to this day.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm talking with him, talking with Jace. We're going to outline. And it dawns on me, and Sean Salisbury shows up and everything. He's carrying on being the fun-loving guy that he is.
Yep.
I realize, Jason, that the show's the audition is going to be live on the air. They don't bring you into a booth. They don't bring you into a room and give you an outline.
No.
The audition was going to be live on the air.
National radio.
So I'm saying to myself, well, if I screw this up, everybody will know.
Yep.
But I said to myself, I'm not going to try to be something different. I'm going to be Freddie Coleman. That's the reason they wanted me here to audition, because they believed that I could be the kind of person that could at least have a shot at this job and have a chance to do that.
Yeah.
But that's how I got here with Jason, the general manager, Bruce Gilbert, heard me driving through, and Jason goes, yeah, I know who that is. I have his number. Let me call him. And that's how I wound up getting here, auditioning one weekend. And after the first audition, Dave Zaslowski goes, can you, come back next weekend? And I said, I had to kind of tell a little white lie to get here because I was working weekends at Pix 106 in Albany.
Mm-hmm.
I said, I can't do Saturday and Sunday next week. I can do Sunday. That's my day off. He goes, that's great. I said, but if you need me again, he goes, yeah, can you do it 2 weekends from now, Saturday and Sunday? I said, yeah, I can make that work and make arrangements.
Mm-hmm.
Here's the funny part of that. One of our engineers who worked up in Albany for the station, that the second weekend I did the audition for ESPN Radio, he comes and he goes, were you on Game Night over the weekend? And I go, I don't know what you're talking about. I'm dancing just like Richard Gere in the movie Chicago, trying to do the whole tap dance. He goes, man, a guy sounded just like you. You have a unique voice and everything. I said, there's a lot of Freddie Colemans out there and everything like that. He goes, I know people that work for ABC. I'll find out. I go, I'm really not at liberty to say. And everything. And so I finally came clean and told him. He goes, that's fine. He said, your secret's safe with me. Go get him. I hope you get the audition. But I thought I was losing my mind. Thinking, I said, that guy sounds just like Freddie Coleman, has the same name, that's worked up in Albany. He said, I didn't mean to confront you, but I had to find out from that standpoint. And he kept the secret until I finally told the people in Albany that they wanted to hire me.
That's a real wrestle for a lot of people who are looking for that next position or that next opportunity. And you're not trying to be sneaky.
No.
But you want to also respect the people that you're currently working with.
Yep.
But also have this opportunity to fall through. I mean, I've seen that for so many people, not in the exact way you just described, but just people who are looking for the next job. Right. And I always, I went through that, to be honest with you. When I was thinking about leaving ESPN, and then I actually had a real opportunity with Sports Spectrum to walk, I remember having a conversation with my wife, like, how do I tell them mm-hmm. that I'm leaving?
Right.
Because I'm not leaving to go to Fox or to go to like Bleacher or somebody that's like a competitor, quote unquote, competitor. Right. But I am leaving, and they could say goodbye right now. They mm-hmm. could say goodbye in 2 weeks, or hopefully I, you know, built up enough equity where they can trust that I'm trying to do this the right way.
Right.
And I told one person, Steve Braban, and I know I've been around Steve a little bit. Mm-hmm. Steve still works, I believe, at ESPN. No, hey, I think he actually just left. But Steve was there for a long time, and his wife Ashley still works there. But Steve, I told him, and I said, I need you just to trust me and let me just tell you and nobody else for now.
Right.
And I didn't know if how that was going to run, but I told him. He was great. He actually said to me, this is the perfect position for you. I'm so happy for you.
Right.
And so that was nice to hear. Mm-hmm. But then we just kept it under wraps for about 2 weeks. Yep. And then after Christmas, and I left February 10th was my last day, I went in and I told a bunch of different people and told Mike and Mike. And everybody was really nice. I gave about 4 weeks notice, and they let me finish it out.
Right.
Because I didn't just want to be gone in 2 weeks. I'm like, please let me. I want to do this the right way because I built too much equity there. Yeah. So that's a real tension for a lot of people.
Yeah, and I wasn't looking to leave because I got up to Albany. I'm doing drive time afternoon radio in a great market. I said to myself, if I stay here for 15, 20 years, if I'm blessed to do that, I would have been completely good with that. ESPN radio wasn't even on my radar. It was so far out there. Yeah. That I wasn't even thinking, okay, I'm going to use this as a stepping stone. I figured if this was going to be the end all the be all, working in Albany, you can have a really good life and have a great career working in a market like that. And it proves that God has a sense of humor. The old line is, you want to make God laugh, have a plan.
Have a plan.
Yeah. And you're from that standpoint. God said, I got this for you. This is to get you where I know you need to be. And it worked out perfectly.
Yeah, I would have been completely content 20 years ago if you told me I was basically replacing Roger Weiland mm-hmm. on News Channel 13 and WMYT, and that would have been my dream job as a kid.
Yep.
ESPN, like you say, in a lot of ways, was so far out that it is a dream job, but I didn't dream big enough, at least for me, when I was younger. Albany would have been the dream. Mm-hmm. So you get to ESPN. There's been a lot of memories. 16 years is a long time, 2004, that you've been there. And so asking you to tell me what your favorite interview is of all this time, that's going to be a hard one, I'm sure, for you.
Yes.
But can you pinpoint one or two moments when you're on the air and you knew something special was happening?
The first time that happened, I'll never forget, one of our contemporaries, a guy you worked with, Mike Golick.
Yeah.
When I first got the ESPN radio, his cubicle and my cubicle were in the same spot downstairs in building number two. And I was filling in on the sports bash one day for Eric Casilius. And Amanda Brown's the producer. And there was a whole thing going on with the NFL Players Association, retired players, about compensation. And it was really a story that was taking off. And it had daddy long legs from that standpoint.
Absolutely.
And I said, hey, Golick, I said, I know you got NFL Live. I know you're resting. I said, if you get a chance, can you come on for a segment to talk about this? Because I knew he would have a strong opinion about it. He goes, absolutely, Freddie, that's not a problem. And he said, I got to figure out with NFL Live. I said, I'm on your schedule. It's not a problem. So he said, I got to do some NFL Live. I'll come over to 6 o'clock hour. How does 6:30, how's 6:15 sound? I said, absolutely. So he comes over, and we're having a great spirited discussion. He's just knocking out of the park like he normally does. Mm. Amanda Brown gets in my ear. She goes, yeah, Gene Upshaw, the leader of the NFL Players Association, is hearing this conversation, and he wants to weigh in. And so I'm thinking, absolutely, like I'm going to turn down Gene Upshaw. So we bring him in, and he and Golick are just going at it. They're two bulls in the ring. They're not backing down. There's no yelling, but there's a respectful volume level between both of these guys holding on to their position. And we blew past the break. P.J. Anderson, he comes in, keep going. At that time, he's one of the program directors. Just keep talking. I said, well, what about the break? Don't worry about the break. Just keep going.
We'll figure it out.
So they're just going back and forth about 20, 25 minutes.
Yeah.
So the whole thing ends, and Gene goes, God rest his soul. He goes, go look, you know I respect you. And Mike goes, Gene, I know I respect you too, but I know how strong you're going to be. I know how strong I'm going to be, and I'm sure this is not the last of this. And he starts laughing. They both start laughing. They say, hey, take care. I'll talk to you soon. So the interview, I said, Golick, man, I really appreciate it. I know we kept you past. He goes, oh, that was fantastic, Freddie. That was not a problem. So he gets up and leaves. PJ Addisini walks and he goes, can we just put that on loop and have that for the rest of the day from that standpoint? And it crystallized me more than ever before. You just never know who is listening.
Yeah.
Mike going out, just having this conversation, Gene Upshaw, Pro Football Hall of Famer, the leader of Players Union, paying attention and wanted to weigh in. And after he finished, he told Amanda Brown, I hope I was okay. I hope I didn't interrupt anything. And Amanda goes, are you kidding? You made my whole day being a part of that. So that was the first time I realized the power of ESPN and ESPN Radio. It's one thing to know Jason when you're on the outside, but when you're on the inside and those four letters have that kind of impact, that's still a moment that I go back to that may not be my favorite moment, but it's the best moment I can use about talking about the power of ESPN, ESPN Radio, yeah, and having a chance to be a part of that.
Well, I think, too, you know, the shows that you and I have both had the experience of working on, when I go on vacation, and a lot of my vacations would take place in Orlando, Florida, at Disney World, right, for obvious reasons.
Right.
And I would be in a hotel room and turn it on, and there's ESPN. Or mm-hmm. I'd be out in San Diego or out in Denver, even now,
yeah,
you know, having been post-ESPN, and I travel a lot more, and I'm out all across the country, and ESPN is on. And we all know that.
Yeah.
But you don't understand that or recognize that unless you work there.
Yep.
The power and the reach that you really have.
Yep.
The
exactly.
amount of people that are tuning in, television, radio, online, podcast now.
Yep.
And Pete, by the way, you mentioned him doing an incredible job leading the ESPN podcast
Absolutely.
World and just rocking it in that world. And you realize, oh my gosh.
Yep.
Even for me, my little Sports Spectrum show, occasionally someone will say, hey, mm-hmm. we're listening to this as a team.
Yep.
And we heard this interview you did with this person. It's like, oh, people are actually listening.
Uh-huh. Yeah.
This isn't just my little world where I hit record.
Yep. Yep.
And you and me are doing an interview and maybe five people listen. There's actually an impact here. Yeah, yeah, and you yeah. probably recognize that.
I even recognize even more many years later when Hugh Jackman, I mean, we're talking about Wolverine,
yeah,
one of the best actors, Renaissance man, and yeah. he comes through the studio and they had a new X-Men movie
doing out, the car wash,
doing the car wash and everything. And I didn't know if I was going to get on the list, but when they said, yeah, you want to be on the list, I said, absolutely.
Yeah.
So Hugh Jackman comes in and he was causing a small scale riot among everybody there because he's such a good guy, but everyone passing that place is mm-hmm. walking in the walls and everything. Mm-hmm. So he comes in, hey, Hugh Jackman, Freddie Coleman, Hugh Jackman. And yeah. people don't realize that he's 6'1", 6'2". We're not talking about a small guy
here. It's a big boy.
Big guy, had like the beard and everything. And he goes, how do you do what you do? And I go, what do you mean? He said, I love when you do, you know, what they said, what Freddie heard. I go, look, I said, what are you talking about? He goes, oh, I drive my wife crazy when I'm in New York or L.A., I said, I don't know how he does that every night for 3 hours because that's when it was the Freddie Coleman show. I said, wait yeah. a minute. I said, are you telling me? He goes, yeah. He said, I love sports talk radio. I listen to you all the time when I'm out in Los Angeles and in New York. I drive my wife nuts because she said, can you turn that off, please? I love your takes. I love how you go about it. I'm thinking, this is Wolverine.
It's
Hugh Jackman. About X-Men? You know, yeah. we're talking about Wolverine, Hugh Jackman. And it was fun. It was cool talking about, yeah, here's how we go about things. I said, it's the way you do when you have storyboards as an actor. We kind of have the same thing, just on a different level. Mm-hmm. And his publisher said, I wish this was on radio right now because this is fascinating to me because I don't know about this.
Wow.
In terms of the way he goes about it and the way you go about it. It was really cool that someone like Hugh Jackman, one of the biggest stars in the galaxy, said, I love what you do and how do you go about it? And then he knew exactly what segments we did. Like he said, what they said, what I heard. And I said, I know his publicist could not have told him that because he knew exactly what it was. So that was a pretty eye-opening moment, having somebody like that. And even on my Facebook personal page, that's the first picture you see is me and Hugh Jackman in the hallway. Mm-hmm. He was so gracious, but he's really, really smart. He's really intelligent. But I don't think I heard, Jason, the first 5 minutes of that interview because I still was reverting back that he said he listens to my show and is a fan of what I do. That was pretty cool to have.
That's awesome. Mm-hmm. I mean, that's kind of like that's the power of ESPN when you yep. realize it, right?
Mm-hmm.
When
Absolutely.
All of a sudden a world-famous actor is just a big sports fan and listens to sports talk radio and yep. it's your show that he listens
yeah,
to.
Yeah, that was just one of the strangest. I went home and told my wife, Denise, that. She goes, wait, what's that now? I said, yeah, Wolverine
yeah.
likes what I do. I said, I'm good no matter what happens now.
Absolutely.
No matter what happens the rest of the day and rest of my career, I got that to hang my hat on. I'm good with that.
Absolutely. That's awesome. Freddie Coleman has been joining us here on Sports Spectrum. I want to ask you this question. I haven't asked any of my ESPN friends this question yet, and it relates to my book. I released a book called The mm-hmm. Uniform of Leadership, yeah. and it's about my time at ESPN. And you're still at ESPN, and it's about the leadership lessons that I learned during my time at ESPN. So I figured, why not ask mm-hmm. someone who's still there What is one leadership lesson that you could take away from your 16 years at ESPN that you just, you remember, maybe it's an experience or a moment or a story that you can share, and you said, man, that was an amazing lesson on this journey that I've been on at the Worldwide Leader?
I'll never forget the first meeting I had with Bruce Gilbert when I first got hired. I'm sitting in his office, and he's congratulating me being part of ESPN family. He gave me the best piece of advice that I still use to this day. He said, it's one thing to be in front of the microphone, but make sure you listen. Make sure you pay attention.
Yes.
And he always told me, he said, there are plenty of people who are terrific leaders that don't mind being followers. That if somebody has a great idea, you recognize that. It can't be about ego. It can't be about status. It can't be about your place. He said, you look back at any great leader or any terrific leader, male or female, young, old, no matter who they are, they've always had the ability to listen and not be afraid to follow. And that is something that has carried me, because it's one thing to understand where you are, but there are plenty of times you say, okay, that's a better idea than what I have. We need to go there. I say, man, did you hear what so-and-so had to say? We need to really sink our teeth into that. And that is something I've never, ever forgotten. The paying attention part of things in life, it's something that's it's just like water coming out of a faucet, that you take it for granted that it's always going to be there. But when it's not there, it's really noticeable that if you want to be heard, or you believe you should be heard, no one's paying attention, or if you fail to pay attention to something and then you miss out on something, you missed out on something really important that could have really affected someone's life or affected your life. So that was the greatest lesson in all the years. And I've gotten some great lessons from people either who are managers, program directors, coworkers, et cetera. But that's the one thing, Jason, that really, really carried me, saying it's okay to pay attention and listen. That doesn't mean it's a sign of weakness. It's a sign of strength, because you're showing that you're investing yourself in what that person has to say, and that person is investing themselves in you, and only good is going to come out of that. Yeah. So if you pay attention, listen closely, and don't be afraid to follow, you'd be amazed what kind of leader that's going to make you.
Listening both from a broadcasting perspective, on
yeah.
air,
yeah,
you have to be, I think the people who are the best interviewers, like you, like others, you know, the Greenies and the Golics and the Bob Lees and the Stuart Scotts and the Dan Patricks, these legends in the business, they're all great listeners mm-hmm. yeah. as interviewers. That's what I've tried to, on a very, again, small level in the interviews right. I do, be a better listener,
yeah,
because that's where the real conversations are going to take place. But also, like you said, away mm-hmm. from the broadcasting world, listening to others,
yeah,
being inclusive, understanding that there are talented people all over the place here.
Yep.
Let them do their thing.
Yeah. And I got the sense he was not talking about radio.
Just he was by talking about life.
He was talking about life. I got that sense that it wasn't something about, okay, the next time you're on the air with John Seibel, make sure you pay attention.
Yeah.
I got that sense from Bruce that that had nothing to do with what I was hoping to accomplish or whatever that was going to be mm-hmm. in front of the microphone, ESPN radio. I got the sense that this was something that you can really have this happen in your life, and that's going to make you a better person. But more importantly, it's going to make better people around you, because why would you not want to be around better people? You'll become a better person because the people around you.
Absolutely.
And that'll raise you up, and you won't even realize it, but people will see it, and then you'll realize it and clearly understand that.
As we wind down here, I'm fascinated to know what this has been like. You know, we're recording this in basically the middle to late part of summer, and we thought that COVID might be gone and that yeah. we'd be kind of moving on to regular sports, and some sports have returned and some might not. And we'll see all that and what happens there. But what has this been like for you? Let's go back to like March 10th or 11th or 12th,
right,
when sports and everything else in this world was shut down. And suddenly you have to spend the next 4 months talking about something that isn't happening and probably recycling content, probably mm-hmm. coming up with topics that maybe otherwise you would have never talked about. But what's it been like for a person who's been in this business a long time to kind of go through what the last 4 or 5 months have been like?
It's been intriguing and interesting, but it's also been fascinating, because you've really been able to find out a lot about what you can do and how you can go about it. My wife, Denise, said it best. She said a lot of people are going to be exposed by what's going to happen. And she meant that in a good and a bad way, because sure. let's say, for example, if you're a radio host, and you rely on callers on the time. Well, you can't just do that all the time. You got to be able to have yourself be put out there a little bit more. You can't just hear sob stories about COVID-19 stinks and this is terrible and where's my football. That hamster on the wheel is going to get old.
Yes.
If you think that's the way you're supposed to go about it. Not saying that's a bad thing, but you got to be able to do something different. And that's the one thing we talked about. Okay, there are other stories out there that we have to pay attention to where live games aren't just pushing it down the pole anymore. It's not pushing it to the bottom. And that's the best thing in terms of dealing with COVID-19 that way, is that now whenever this goes away, whenever it slows down, whenever there's whatever normalcy, that whatever that's going to be, that doesn't mean you go away from those stories and you go away from the people that you talk to or those kind of disciplines you talk to. It's been really cool talking to different people that aren't concerned about games, that talk about their life experiences. For example, I had Brittany Sykes, a WNBA player, on last week. They're getting ready to go into the before the season got started.
Yeah.
And it was cool hearing how she was having a chance to talk about the leadership of the WNBA and how they're pioneers and how they're role models, and getting her thoughts on Elena Deladon and what she's going through, taking 64 pills a day, dealing with Lyme disease, have to deal with that from the WNBA doctors.
Yeah.
It was really cool talking to people that we might not have thought about talking to, or situations or aspects that we might not wanted to deal with because live sports were taking center stage. It's been really cool thinking going forward, we can still do that in addition to live sports. It not only makes the show better, but it's going to make you better because now you have an understanding. You're going to have a different level of saying, okay, I want to hear about that now. And it's not just going to go underneath the carpet just because live sports have come back, no matter what sports are going to do that.
Yeah, it's a crazy time. What's been the weirdest time or weirdest thing for you during all this time? Because it's not just sports. I mean, we're talking about a climate that is politically divisive right now. We're talking about a racial divide and the climate that's been happening with that. So as a black man, but as just a human being, what's this been like for you kind of processing all of this as a man of faith? What's this been like?
It's part of evolution, in my opinion, because I think about what this world has gone through. The bubonic plague, for example, the Spanish flu, World War I, World War II. There's always been something in a century or in a decade where it puts the world and usurps everything. We've seen that before. COVID-19 has a different face when it comes to that, but it's all along the lines of, okay, this is going to upset your everyday living. This is going to upset your everyday mindset.
Yeah.
And how you deal with that, I'm not going to say brings out characteristics in you that you may not have thought, but it's going to explain a lot about you going forward, in my opinion. There are some people that don't deal with change properly. They really don't like it. They want everything to be rainbows and butterflies. But life has never been like that. And some people don't like change. They don't like things being turned around. Nobody does. But that doesn't mean you retreat. That means you find a way to go forward and say, okay, how can I keep myself safe? How can I keep my family safe? What am I going to do to be better to make sure that if something else happens, it's not just going to throw me for a loop and knock me down and keep me down for a little bit? So no matter what has gone on in the world, my mindset, Jason, has always been, okay, this is another left turn that our world has to deal with, whether it's individually or whether it's going to be collectively. We're not dealing with anything that somebody else has not had to deal with on a different face, in a different century, in a different lifetime, no matter where they are. So I guess I've never allowed it to keep me down. You better find a way to adapt. And if you don't find a way to adapt, then as hard as it is, it's going to be a lot harder for you because you've made it a lot harder on yourself and people around you. And not trying to make things easier, trying to sugarcoat things, but any way you can find some familiarity to find your faith and lean on that faith and stay steadfast in that faith, yeah, that's going to carry you through. That's going to allow you to see things through. So even if it's COVID-19, that's happening now in 2020, 5 years now could be something else. But that does mean you take a step back and stay there. You get knocked back a little bit. You dust yourself off. You lean on your faith and you keep going forward. What's the old line that Stuart Scott said? If you go through hell, keep going. You know, don't just stand there.
Yeah.
Ask for help. It's okay to ask for help. But if you're going through something, keep going. That doesn't mean you stop and allow that to take over you.
Yeah, I loved it. I mean, we were just talking. I had Chris Broussard on a couple weeks ago on the podcast. And him and I talked about Stu and just the impact that he made, the influence that he made, but the encouragement that he brought in watching him fight through.
Sure.
And that's a good reminder, man. You got a favorite Stu story for you?
I'll tell you, I'm glad you mentioned that. The last time I saw him alive, and I'll never forget this as long as I live, it was about 9 months before he passed away. and he had just finished SportsCenter. So usually he would finish SportsCenter, we would get off at about the same time. And sometimes I would see him, sometimes I wouldn't, but yeah. I hadn't seen him in a minute. And so I see him come up the steps. I go, "Stu, my man, how are you doing?" He goes, "I'm hanging in there, man. You know, I'm not going to let this defeat me. You know, I really appreciate the support." I said, "Dude, you stand on our shoulders. We got you." He said, "I know that." He said, "I'm really appreciative." He said, "Freddie, thank you guys for everything. It means the world to me." And I gave him a hug, and it's like I didn't want to let him go.
Wow.
Seriously. And I never saw him alive again. But that memory will always last with me, knowing that that was the last time I had a chance to see him. And then at his memorial service that we had, and we knew it was going to be emotional. We all expected that, especially when his daughters, when they got up and sang the wedding song, that would have been there had he been able to live. And I remember talking with his brother and his fiance, and his brother told me, he said, "Stu and I used to talk about you all the time." And I go, "What are you talking about?" He goes, he said he was such a fan of you on the air and as a person. And we used to have you would start arguments between us all the time. But I can't believe Freddie said that and everything. He said, "Believe me." And just hearing that, and I said to myself, "Wow, I mean, you just never know." Because, I mean, all of us were fans of Stuart. I mean, people don't realize what a pioneer he was, that he really changed the game.
Changed the game.
Yeah, people said, "You can't be that way on the air." And he goes, "Oh, yeah, watch me." Yeah. And he did. And you see, many Stuart Scotts everywhere trying to do what he was able to do when he started that first. But hearing that from his brother, it meant the world to me. And it took me back to the last time I saw him and gave him a hug and didn't want to let him go. And I still miss him every day. And I know people were closer to him than I was, but that doesn't mean that he didn't impact my life a lot more than maybe he even realized when he was on this earth.
Yeah, he's still impacting people's lives to this day. I can't believe it's been 5+ years since he's been gone.
Yeah,
but what a legend he was. Let me ask you this, Freddie, as we wind down. This is the last question we asked all of our guests here on the show. What's God been teaching you right now? I mean, there's a lot of right now in your life between a new contract, a pandemic, a radio show that you're doing, certainly your family, everything else that we've described that's happening right now. What's the lesson? What's the great moment or the great kind of thing that the Lord has impressed upon your heart that he's teaching you right now?
I think the one thing that I've carried with me, Jason, is that I know he's always there. I never have to think about any more of being alone. And I know it can be very easy for people to say, in this life, I have no one. And even if you believe that somebody's close to you, you could be married to somebody, but you feel that you're separated from them, that you feel they can't help you, or you don't want to burden them with your issues. I know I'm never alone because I can ask God anything. I can talk to him about anything. I can say, "Thank you for this. What about this? Okay, I thank you for my mom and my dad and my wife and my daughter and the rest of my family. I thank you for the blessings that you continue to give me." But I also can say, "You know, I know we're going through a tough time, but I know you're going to see us through. You've done it before. And those who don't want to be seen through, I don't question your plan. You don't have to explain to me exactly why this is happening. This is your way of saying that, hey, it's not the first time, won't be the last time. What are you going to do about it? But make sure that you understand that I'm always, always going to be here. You may not get the answer or get the result that you want on your time, but you're not on your time. Mm. It's on his time. It's on his clock. And I think a lot of people want things yesterday. And then when you don't get them yesterday, then you feel as if there's no reason to try to find out or try to keep going. That's his way of saying, I'm always going to be here. I'm never going to leave your side. But if you leave me, then you can't expect that things are going to get better from an inside part, a heart standpoint, and your mind standpoint. So that's the one thing I've always been able to take with me, no matter what's going on in my life, especially finding him or him making sure I come back to his fold, that I know he's always going to be there. And he's always going to see us through, no matter what timeline we may think that we should be seen through.
He is Freddie Coleman, ESPN radio host. You can see him or listen to him, I should say, with Freddie and Fitzsimmons, 9 p.m. to midnight Eastern on ESPN radio. Man, I'm so happy for you with your new contract.
You,
and this has been a long time coming. I'm so glad that we were able to do this interview, and let's do it again.
Sooner than soon, Jason. God bless you, my man. Take care.
And many thanks to Freddie Coleman for joining us here today on Sports Spectrum. And what a great dude he is. Every single time I've come in contact with him, whether it was at ESPN or even when we recorded this interview, this conversation today, he's always been encouraging to me. He's always made me smile, and we've just always got along. And I just love that about him. And I know when he posted about this new contract that he got on social media, on Twitter, he's at Coleman ESPN. You will see all the people that responded to him and that encouraged him and that understood the impact that he made on their lives. What a great dude. So glad that he shared his story with us here today on Sports Spectrum. Freddie Coleman, give him a follow on Twitter if you could, at ColemanESPN. ColemanESPN. Thanks to Freddie. And thanks again to our partners, IJM, the International Justice Mission. Check them out at ijm.org/TF. Join the fight against violence and oppression and ending slavery in our lifetime over at IJM, the International Justice Mission. And also thank you to Compassion International, the most trusted child development ministry in the world. Check them out at compassion.com/teamup to be a part of the great work they are doing to release children from poverty. We also want to direct you to our website, sportspectrum.com. That's the home base for all of our content here at the Ministry of Sports Spectrum, sportspectrum.com. And if you're listening to this podcast on Apple Podcasts and their app, do us a favor and click that subscribe button and then leave us a review if you could, a review of the podcast. It would help us go a long way to letting other people know about Sports Spectrum. It just helps raise the awareness, and any help you can provide in letting people know about our little ministry here at Sports Spectrum would be amazing. Again, leave a review, click that subscribe button, and never miss an episode of Sports Spectrum's podcast. Thanks again for tuning in, and we'll see you next time. My name is Jason Romano. Love you guys. I hope you all have a great rest of your day.